Hi, this is Graham. Hope everyone's having a great day and welcome to this hints and tips video where I'll be looking at the manual exposure mode with the Panasonic Lumix FZ200 camera. It's part of my hints and tips series and it's part of the ebook that I'll be producing for users of the FZ200 camera. So keep your eye on this channel for some release dates for the initial chapters of the book on the FZ200. In today's video, I want to look at demystifying taking pictures using the manual exposure mode. Remember, it's my quest to try and move people from using the IA mode to using at least the semi-automatic modes where you get a little bit more creativity with your pictures to the full manual mode where that unleashes all your full potential to create some fantastic images using this camera. In this particular video, I'm going to show you the practical aspects of balancing the equation of the exposure triangle. And the exposure triangle is the relationship of the aperture, the shutter speed and the ISO to give you the perfect exposure. You can liken it to a mathematical equation. So if you've got the answer, then if the component parts of the answer are the aperture, the shutter and the ISO, if you multiply those three together, you get the perfect exposure. If I change any component of those three separate items, if I reduce the aperture, for example, if I go from f4 to an f7.1, I'm reducing the amount of light that goes through to reach the sensor. So to balance the equation, I need to either increase the time that that light is falling on the sensor, or I need to increase the camera sensitivity by moving up the ISO. So whatever I do to one component, I've got to do the equal and opposite to either one or the other two of the equation. And I'll be showing you that in the demonstration. So the key to the manual exposure with the FZ200 is the exposure meter on the back of the camera. It gives you an indication of when you've got the correct exposure or not. In conjunction with that, you can actually use what's called a histogram. And the histogram is just a feature which shows you the tonal distribution of all the pixels in the picture. So it shows you the distribution from shadows through midtones to highlights. The camera just displays the tonal range that the camera is seeing. But when you half depress the shutter button, the histogram becomes a valuable tool because it shows you the distribution after the effect of your shutter or aperture or ISO adjustment. So if you're seeing any difference between when you half depress the shutter button and the live view mode, you know you're either underexposing or underexposing. And again, I'll show you that in the video. So you've got two useful tools to get the perfect exposure. If you want to introduce deliberate under or overexposure, then of course you can use the scale on the meter to show you just how much you're under or overexposing the image. Let's get started. Let's have a look at now setting up the camera to do a manual exposure. Let's set up for manual exposure to begin with. And of course you do that by turning the top control mode dial to the M position. That's indicated by the M on the top left hand side of your LCD screen. So this is the screen you're presented with when you switch to the manual mode. The confirmation that you're in manual mode by the M icon on the top left-hand side of the screen. And then the three principal components of your exposure. Aperture, shutter, and ISO. You have to decide which is the highest priority in the equation, be it shutter priority or aperture priority. Remember, aperture will govern your depth of field and shutter will determine the amount of subject movement. So if you want maximum depth of field, then you're going to be using aperture as your key component. If you want to stop action in sports, then you're going to be using shutter as your key component. In the tabletop demonstration I've here, I want aperture to be my principal component as I want to get the maximum depth of field. So I'm going to be using the aperture control to set up the aperture that I want. To gain access to either the shutter speed or the aperture, we need to use the back control dial, and whichever of the two components is in yellow indicates which you've got control of. At the moment the shutter is being adjusted by the back control dial, but I want to change that to the aperture, and to do that by pressing inwards on the back control dial. You can now see that the aperture control has turned to yellow. I want to set an aperture of f4, as that gives me the best image conditions using this lens. So I will dial in f4, and I need to go to a larger number, which is a smaller aperture. So I'm going to turn the control dial to my right. So as I turn to the right, the numbers will increase. So I've now got to f4. Obviously we want to try and keep the ISO as low as possible, and that will depend on the ambient light. So try to keep that as low as possible, which will give you a shutter speed which is manageable for the type of shot you're taking. So if it's handheld, you want to be more than a 1/30 of a second, and if you're taking sports, obviously that needs to be much higher. In this situation, I'm using an ISO of 250, as that gives me a reasonable exposure in the lighting conditions I've got set up at the moment. The key to understanding the manual exposure is this manual exposure scale here. The moment you can see, it's heavily biased to the left-hand side, which means the image is grossly underexposed. If I was to take that picture now, you'd notice that the picture is extremely dark. You can see it's grossly underexposed, more than three stops underexposed. So with our controls, the idea is to bring this indicator scale back to zero, which will be the ideal exposure. You might notice that I have displayed on the screen what's called the histogram control, and you can enable that in the tools menu. It's a useful tool as it gives me a distribution of the light and dark pixels within this image. Over on the left hand side are all the dark areas, the blacks and shadows. Over on the right hand side is all the highlights or bright areas. On the little model I placed there, I put my two white balance cards. So here we have a white card, and here we have an 18% reflectance card, which is neutral grey. So that neutral grey is this heavily peaked area in the centre, and this white peak is the highlights coming from that card. The histogram at this point only displays the distribution of tones. It doesn't tell me whether the exposure is correct or not. Quite a lot of books refer to the histogram, and the distribution of the tones tells you whether you're correctly exposed or not. Here with the FZ200, it's showing you the distribution of tones, not the actual exposure. To see the effect on the histogram of the exposure, you need to half depress the shutter button, or in this case, I'm going to half press the remote release. So you can see now the histogram has biased itself all the way down to the left hand side. So it's saying within this image now, all I'm recording are these shadows. There is no mid-tones and there's no highlights. And you can see that in the live view mode of the picture. So what we have to do is balance this equation by switching over to the shutter speed and then allowing more time for the exposure to take place. So I'm going to take control of the shutter by pressing in the back control dial. And you can see that if we are underexposed, we need to turn this dial in the same direction. So if this is on the left hand side, turn the dial to the left hand side. And you want to do that until the control starts to move towards the center point. You notice now the shutter times are getting longer. We're allowing more light to reach that center. So at this point, the exposure meter is showing that we are at the correct exposure point. And if you notice, the histogram has turned white. It means that we've not got any under or overexposure. Remember, the histogram displays the tonal range. Nothing has changed in the distribution of that curve. All it's done is now show us that we're at the correct operating point. We are showing a white icon. If I half press the shutter button again, you will see no change in the live view image, and you won't see any change on the histogram. So you can see there's a very, very, very slight shift of the histogram, but there's no change in the distribution of the image. So if I take that picture now, the histogram is displaying exactly what we saw on the camera. We've got a good distribution of tones from shadows all the way through to highlights. So that was setting aperture and controlling the exposure using shutter. Let's look at this from the other equation point of view. We want to set a shutter speed of, say, 1/250 of a second to capture a sports action. So I'm going to dial in 1/250 of a second. So now see we're underexposed. So to balance that equation, I now have to change my ISO, make the camera more sensitive, or increase the amount of light coming through the lens by opening the aperture, going to a smaller f-stop. So let's take control of the aperture first of all by clicking the back control dial. Again, the control has turned yellow. So I'm going to turn the control dial in the direction that the meter is showing me. So I'm going to turn the dial to the left. that brings up the exposure. You notice now that I've got to f2.8, which is the biggest aperture this camera supports, and I'm still underexposed. So to get the equation right, I will now need to increase the ISO sensitivity. You can see that we are 1 2/3 stops underexposed. There are 5 divisions showing on the scale. So in the ISO, I need to come down 5 positions if I've got the exposure value range set to 1/3 of an increment. If I press the ISO button, you need to go down 5 complete divisions to balance the equation. You can see now the equation is balanced with ISO 800. So once again, if I half depress the shutter button, there's no change to the shape of the histogram, there's no change to the live view mode, and we've got the perfect exposure. So then we've had to use both components to get the exposure correct. I needed the 1/250th of the shutter speed, but there wasn't enough ambient light to enable me to use the widest aperture, so I had to increase the ISO, or the camera sensitivity, to get the exposure correct. Remember, with that exposure triangle, there's always a trade-off. If you increase the ISO sensitivity, you run the risk of increasing the noise in the picture. If you go from a small f-stop, that's a large f number, say f7.1, and I want to increase the exposure, I need to open the aperture, which means going to a smaller f number. If you go to a smaller f number, then you're restricting the depth of field. So again, it's important to understand the wider the aperture, the shallower the depth of field. That might be something you want in the picture, or it might work against you. For example, if you're shooting macro shots, you need as much depth of field as you can get, so you need to be setting up to about f7.1. If you're recording sports events, you need obviously to capture the action, so you need a higher shutter speed. So once you set that higher shutter speed, first of all, try and balance the exposure using your aperture, and if you can't get that with the maximum aperture of f2.8, then the only recourse you have is to switch to the ISO and start to increase that until you get the meter balanced. Well, that's it for the video, and hopefully that's demystified some of the topics around manual exposure. There'll be a hints and tips card that I'll produce to go along with this video, and of course it'll be expanded more in my ebook to tell you more about camera sensitivity, ISO and those sort of things. So keep your eyes on the channel for some release dates for the initial chapters, and finally how to download the final book and where it'll be available. That's it for the video. If you're new to this channel and haven't already clicked the subscribe button, please consider clicking the subscribe button. That will give you notification when I do upload any more hints and tips videos, or any camera tutorials, or any product reviews. So until my next video, thanks very much for watching, take care, and goodbye for now.